dear ladies and gentlemen of technology and science, thank you to all of you for being here this afternoon. Let me introduce myself once again to all of you. I am Kalpana and I am an alien. I come not from your world, but a different world. You are from the universe of clear-cut problems, linear logic, and neat solutions. I belong to the world of wicked problems, clumsy methods, and messy solutions. So that is why I titled my talk today, A Messy Intrusion into Your Methodical World. Dear lovely ladies and gentlemen, let me give you a peek into my world in the next 20 minutes or so. My world is a world where seven blind men try and describe an elephant. Let me give you an illustration. A few weeks ago, I was in Mysore along with a group of administrators, educationists, engineers and architects to study the feasibility of setting up a new university in the outskirts of the heritage town. As we inspected the proposed location, which spread over many acres of land, we tried to visualize an educational hub with teeming libraries and scholars and open spaces and smart classrooms. As we walked along, we found, to our dismay, that an irrigation canal ran right through the land, cutting across what would be the built-up area which would actually house the university building. How did we react? The engineer said, "We will raise a wall on either side. We will hide the canal from view." Construction was their first thought. The promoters, who were educationists, said, "We will contact the irrigation department. We will do exactly as they say. We will follow all their rules." Compliance was their focus. The architect said, "No, no. We will lay a tree-lined avenue on either side of the canal and have seats where students can relax or study." Aesthetics was their way to go. And the administrators, including myself, we said, "What happens if there are heavy rains? The canal may overflow. So safety of the students and day-to-day hygiene has to be ensured. Worse, if the canal gets blocked for any reason, then the adjacent farmers will protest. So any blockage within the campus has to be prevented a priori." So, faced with the same situation, we have a medley of perspectives, a basket of solutions. And the public policy maker has to navigate her way and find a solution that is legally tenable, financially viable, technologically feasible, politically acceptable, socially desirable, and administratively doable. Well, what will finally happen with the Mysore canal? We have to wait and see. But one good did come out of this. I had been trying to persuade the promoters that there should be a school for public policy in the university. This live demonstration was enough to get them to agree to my proposition. For an outsider, government appears hierarchical. But in my world, the back and forth of dialogue, discussion, and consultation, of give and take, often works better than authority. many years ago, I worked in a power transmission company. I found that our core activity, that is transmission, had been outsourced. Our substations were run by contractors who employed temporary engineers. Why? The reason was that our neoliberal efforts, you remember LPG, it was all in vogue at one time, those neoliberal efforts to make the public sector lean and mean constrained us from replacing the natural attrition of retiring engineers with fresh recruitment. I was then fresh returned from IIM Bangalore, and I convinced the political executive that our core activity should be performed by our own personnel and that we needed fresh, regular recruits. But I faced resistance from an unexpected quarter. Hundreds of temporary engineers, egged on by the powerful contractors' lobby and backed by some engineers too, sat on dharna before the chief minister's residence. The situation was, because if we recruited, then they would lose their jobs. The contractors would lose their contracts and they would lose their jobs. The situation became volatile, and my boss sent me to tackle that situation. He sent me not because of any great faith in my ability, but because he held me responsible for a wacky idea, and because he secretly hoped that I would get ticked off by the chief minister, or even better, bashed up by those protesting youth. I had to literally think up a solution in the 2 kilometer distance between my office and the chief minister's residence. And I did. Before I met the CM, I sat with the protesting youth. I asked them whether they were willing to participate in the recruitment. They thought a little, but pointed out that some of them held diplomas, not degrees. So we thought whether recruitment of different levels was possible and whether a certain weightage could be given for the service which they had already rendered. We met the chief minister together and we had a rudimentary plan on which there was a broad consensus. Discussion and give and take had brought us closer to a solution. It was a win-win where everyone was happy. Well, not everyone. My boss was severely disappointed. I live in a world of relationships where you are remembered in minds and hearts long after you are out of sight, where one small word or gesture can make a world of difference to someone's life. I met Sunidhi Manjunath in Chikmagalur a few months ago, all of 12 years old. This 7th standard student of the Asha Kirana Blind School captivated me with her agility in chess. Sunidhi is fully visually challenged, but her skin and her smile belie this. No wonder then that Sunidhi won the first prize in the first national open FIDE rating chess tournament for the visually challenged in Goa in April 2019. This is the message from Sunidhi's parents that I received. Hartika Danyavadagalu, madam. Thank you very much, madam. That's what they say. Tamma Kalaji Kakkaligalu. ಆ ಮಗುವಿನ ಭವಿಷ್ಯದ ಅತಿ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಆಶಾಕಿರಣಗಳು. ಯುವರ್ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಕನ್ಸರ್ನ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಬಿಕಮ್ ದ ಆಶಾಕಿರಣ ಆಫ್ ಹರ್ ಲೈಫ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ದೇ ಅಟ್ರಿಬ್ಯೂಟೆಡ್ ಹರ್ ವಿನ್ನಿಂಗ್ ದ ಟೋರ್ನಮೆಂಟ್ ಟು ದಟ್ ಬ್ರೀಫ್ ಮೂಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಎನ್ಕರೇಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆರ್ ಅಫೆಕ್ಷನ್ ವಿಚ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಶೋನ್ ಹರ್ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ಮೈ ವಿಸಿಟ್. ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಅ ಮೆಸೇಜ್ ದಟ್ ಐ ಚೆರಿಶ್. ಅ ಚಾನ್ಸ್ ಮೀಟಿಂಗ್ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ರಿಸಲ್ಟೆಡ್ ವಿತ್ ಅ ಲೈಫ್ ಲಾಂಗ್ ಅಸೋಸಿಯೇಷನ್. ಇನ್ ಸಚ್ ಅ ಮಿಲು of varying perspectives, conflicting dialogues, and the ups and downs of relationships, how does policy policy get made and implemented? Specifically, how do we encourage more women in science and technology? I narrated Sunidhi's tale for a reason. For me, this child epitomizes the self-reliance that I would like to see in all women. The problems of women in science and technology are well documented. Despite progress, women scientists are still paid less, promoted less frequently, win fewer grants, and are more likely to leave research than similarly qualified men. All these are from reports that have been made by scientists themselves. But is there any single individual, group, or institution that is not disadvantaged in some way or other? So, if the paucity of women in science is the wicked problem, there are things that we can do, that you can do. First, put the data together. Whenever a wicked problem rears its head, especially a problem related to women, the first reaction is skepticism. The best antidote to doubt, in my experience, is truth. Hence, collect, and disseminate data. Data in the form of numbers and figures, but also anecdotal data of specific instances. What are the numbers, longitudinal and pan-Indian, of women in science? How many girls take up PCMB or PCMC in school? How many continue to a technical education? How many actually take up science as a career? And so on and so forth. Data brings focus on the central issue. Data helps the seven blind men realize that the elephant in the room is the need to bring more women into science and make them thrive there. Second, talk about it. You are highly educated women, privileged women. Creating awareness is not just a possibility, it is your responsibility. Create fora, as you have done, within your institution and network with other women. Encourage others to share their experiences and write about what they think. I could find a solution in a volatile situation because I was open to speak to the aggrieved stakeholder. Dialogue, discussion, the exploration of solutions, consultations, these are not futile or a waste of time. This is how policy change happens. Third, form a collective. A collective not just of women who are already in the STEM railway compartment, but those who are outside and trying to get it. In a fiercely competitive world, we harbor a fallacy that our success lies in the failure of others. No. The fewer we are, whatever our community, the less our clout and bargaining power. The more we are, the more our issues get mainstreamed. So, get out of yourself. Embrace the larger community of women. Encourage girls to take up science. Mentor your colleagues. Take advice from those who have gone before you. Invest your time for others, and the rewards are rich. Dear sisters and brothers in science, I do not know whether we will leave this room wise and empowered. I don't even know whether I am qualified to show you the way. But I am convinced that the way to wisdom and empowerment lies in us, in our common sisterhood. In our country, everyone knows the problem. Most know the solution to the problem. But there are just a courageous